I'm Lee Llewellyn, and I'm one of the co-chairs of the Young Lawyers Committee for the New York Courts Historical Society. Our society was founded 15 years ago by the late Chief Judge Judith S. Kaye to preserve and protect New York's rich legal history. If you enjoy tonight, I'd ask you to take one of our flyers that you either got it already or you get it on the way out and learn more about us. Our next event is on the Great Documents of New York, and that's on November 30th at the New York City Bar. It's free and open to the public. Tonight we'll hear from three speakers who will tell us aspects about a great American and Polish hero, General Tadeusz Kosciuszko. You know, it wasn't all that long ago that I moved here and I thought to myself, who's this Kosciuszko guy? But if anyone here has difficulty saying Kosciuszko, here's a tip from a Welshman. It's best to just skip every other letter. In all seriousness though, those questions, who is Kosciuszko, what did he do, why does he remain relevant, those speak to the heart of what we're trying to do here today at events like this, make the past new. Tonight's event was co-organized by the Fraunces Tavern Museum, our society, and the Polish Cultural Institute. The director, Anna Domanska, is here tonight. I'd like to give a special thanks to Mazda Mazurek. She designed tonight's event. When she's not programming diplomatic policy like this at the Institute, you can find her starring in the documentary Kosciuszko, A Man Before His Time, as Kosciuszko's first love. That documentary is now being broadcast on 70% of PBS stations across America. Over the next few months, with more and more stations broadcasting it. I'd also like to give a special welcome to one of the producers of the film, Ava Szyjanowski, who's here tonight. As always, I'd also like to thank Marilyn Marcus, Dan, and Allison, without whom tonight wouldn't be possible. I think Kosciuszko still matters. I think Kosciuszko still matters because at a time when our country seems to be increasingly looking inward, it helps to remember that our liberty was bought at a price, and the people who paid that price weren't all Americans. Some came from distant shores, drawn by the promise of what a free country might offer the world. To paraphrase Lin-Manuel Miranda and what he said of another famous foreign contributor to the Revolutionary War, it was immigrants that got the job done, and none more than Kosciuszko. To speak on that, we have three wonderful presenters tonight. The first, Professor Paul Finkelman, will talk about Kosciuszko's will. Professor Finkelman currently holds the Fulbright Chair in Human Rights and Social Justice at the University of Ottawa School of Law. He received a PhD from the University of Chicago and a bachelor's degree from Syracuse University. He was also the fellow in law and humanities at Harvard Law School. He's the author of more than 50 books and countless scholarly articles. He's written on Thomas Jefferson in his book, Slavery and the Founders, Race and Liberty in the Age of Jefferson. His next book, Supreme Injustice, Slavery in the Nation's Highest Court, will be published by Harvard University Press in 2018. Both books discuss litigation over Kosciuszko's will. Professor Finkelman's maternal grandmother was born outside of Warsaw and immigrated to the United States around 1905. His paternal grandfather grew up in a small village in southern Poland in the region known as Galicia and immigrated to the United States around 1900. Our second presenter, Alex Straczynski, will present on Kosciuszko's biography. Alex Straczynski is a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist, award-winning author, director, and president emeritus and chairman of the board of the Kosciuszko Foundation. He's also writer and director of the documentary I mentioned. He's a former city editor of the New York Sun, founding editor of AM New York, and has been published in the Wall Street Journal, the Chicago Tribune, the New York Post, and many other publications. His book, The Peasant Prince, Thaddeus Kosciuszko and the Era of Revolution, won, among many other honors, the Fraunces Tavern Book Award. Straczynski received a master's degree in journalism from Columbia University and a bachelor's degree from the State University of New York at New Paltz. He also received a postgraduate fellowship at the University of Warsaw. Our third presenter, Magdalena Baczewska, will perform a mini concert featuring Kosciuszko's original compositions. Born in Poland, Magdalena has enjoyed a multifaceted career as a pianist, harpsichordist, educator, recording artist, producer, and administrator. She has performed with the San Francisco Symphony and the Chinese National Symphony, among others. She has appeared in concert with violinist Joshua Bell and collaborates extensively with Oscar and Grammy-winning composer Tan Dunn. Performances has taken her to Carnegie Hall, Davies Symphony Hall in San Francisco, and the National Center for Performing Arts in Beijing. A laureate of international piano competitions, she is a recipient of the Outstanding Achievement Award from the Polish Minister of Culture. Baczewska holds degrees from Mannes College and the Manhattan School of Music. She's currently Director of Music Performance and Lecturer at Music at Columbia University in the city of New York. Finally, we'll finish tonight with a toast presented by Magda Mazurek. And with that, I'd like to welcome up Professor Finkelman. Thank you.
I, of course, want to begin by thanking the Tavern Museum, the Polish Cultural Institute, the Historical Society for the New York Courts, especially Marilyn, who I have reminded me that I spoke for the Society more than a decade ago in Buffalo at a time when I was teaching in Albany, and there was a direct flight from Albany to Buffalo, which was delayed, and then canceled. And I called her up and said, I can't make it. You know, I can't get from Albany to Buffalo, and the plane's not flying, and they claim there'll be another plane. I don't believe them. And she said, well, you have to be here. Sit tight. And 10 minutes later, she called me up and she said, a uniformed officer of the New York State Courts will be at your house in 10 minutes. And I don't know if any of you have ever driven from Albany to Buffalo, but we did it in under 3 hours. And it was one of the highlights of my life. finally, I want to thank Magda from the Polish Cultural Institute and Lee Llewellyn from Lanker, Sifford & Wall for helping to arrange this. I was supposed to be in Las Vegas tonight at a convention, and all I can say is that Lee is a very persuasive advocate, and if you need a lawyer, he's probably the guy you want to get, because I'm here. I was at the consulate earlier today, and I thank the Polish consulate for helping arrange me to be here, and that, of course, is, as those of you who are lawyers understand, legally the sovereign territory of Poland. And so this marked the first time in my immediate family in more than 100 years that one of us has gone back to Poland. But given their hospitality, I hope it's not the last time, at least for me. And now we turn to the honored guest here virtually, Tadeusz Kosciuszko. And we need to think about why are we here to think about him and who is he. Approaching him is not easy. First of all, there's the problem, as Lee pointed out, of how you pronounce this guy's name, especially if you're driving with a New York cab driver. But what's fascinating is that he has appeared in name or in visage on postage stamps and statues around the United States and the world. His name graces streets, mountains, a national park, an island in Alaska, of all things, a county in Indiana, a town in Mississippi. I would love to know how they pronounce their town name. And most importantly of all, for those of us who have lived in Brooklyn, as I have, the bridge that gets you to LaGuardia. So he's an important figure for a variety of cultural reasons. The other problem is that, with the exception of the biography written by the next speaker and a book called Three Friends of Liberty, which ironically is co-authored by a boyhood friend of mine, Graham Hodges, who teaches at Colgate, there is very little scholarship in English on him. And it is very hard to really get a handle of him as a complete human being. There are narrower slices. There are so if you want to know about him in the revolution, we can read a book about the general, or we can read a book about the military engineer. We can read a book about Poland and the Kosciuszko Rebellion. But while he's memorialized at West Point, which he helped in design, at the Saratoga National Historical Battlefield, where he helped turn the revolution around. There's not much literature on him, so pulling him together is not an easy task. There, I find, of course, the chair of the board of the society here, and I would only urge you to sponsor a lot of very serious scholarship, because it's important that we know more and we understand better both the man and the world that he lived in. A quick summary of his life puts it in context. Born in 1746 to a noble family of quite modest economic status, they would have been what the British might call the lesser nobility or the upper gentry. His father died when he was 9 and his mother died 11 years later. He entered a military academy in 1765, which is a fairly normal route for someone of noble or high birth who doesn't have a lot of other assets. So you go into the military. But he got to the military academy by patronage from wealthier families within Poland. He then studies in Paris. After the first partition of Poland in 1772, he was effectively in exile, living in France, then Switzerland, then Italy, before setting out for what becomes the United States in 1776. As a European-trained military engineer and a military officer, he was a hugely valuable asset to Washington and to the Continental Line. There were not very many good engineers in the Army, and he became, of course, one of the best, if not the best. His motivations for America, coming to America, are, I'm sure, complicated. On one hand, he was an out-of-work soldier. And this was a time when out-of-work soldiers did not necessarily know national borders or uniforms or flags. Soldiers went from country to country to country. I was reading in something else I was doing the correspondence between the Secretary of War and various people at the very, very beginning of the U.S. Civil War. By the way, some of you may be wondering about my tie, which of course is a tie. This is my response to Confederate monuments. These are the real heroes of the American Civil War: Grant, Sherman, Sheridan, Butler, General Howard, General Custer. These are the people who did what Kosciuszko would have liked to have done, which was to end slavery. And so I'm wearing this tie in their honor, knowing full well that had he lived another 50 years, he would have been a Union general and a Union engineer to fight slavery. But at the very beginning of the Civil War, there is a letter from a guy who is an American, trained as a soldier, who had been a major in the Turkish army in the Crimean War. And now he's back in the U.S. volunteering for service. So this is not an uncommon thing for the 18th century and the 19th century. You go where you can find work. Your work happens to be running armies and leading armies. And so the immigrants who get the job done, von Steuben, Pulaski, Lafayette, Thaddeus Kay. You know, we could do that, when the head of the Soviet Union, the non-lamented late Soviet Union, had a K in his name, as in Khrushchev. He was always known as Mr. K, so we could call him Thaddeus K. Or when Henry Kissinger was known as Henry the K. So here we go. They come because there is a cause and there is a place for them. The cause, of course, is real, because all of the Europeans who came here understand the nature of liberty. They are clearly sympathetic to the idea that you should create a nation based on liberty and based on self-government. Probably the Poles were the most clear on this, because they were, of course, were in a country that was constantly threatened with dismemberment by larger and more powerful and vicious neighbors to both the East and the West. And so he comes here in part because he's looking for work, in part because there is a cause, and in part because the cause relates to his own personal patriotism from the country of his birth. He gets here, he becomes a major figure. he helps win the revolution. There is no question that Saratoga is the turning point of the revolution, and I urge all of you, those of you who live here in downstate New York and never have figured out how to get over the Tappan Zee Bridge, I urge you to come up to Albany, go to General Schuyler's home, the father-in-law of what's his name, and then to proceed up to the Saratoga battlefield, because only when you tour it, only when you drive through it, only when you see it, do you understand the engineering feat that defeats General Burgoyne's army and really levels that army and changes the nature of the war and brings France in as an American ally. And then he goes home. The war is over. He goes back to Poland. He returns to France. He goes back to Poland again. He starts a revolution. He loses the revolution. He ends up in a Russian prison for a number of years. He is paroled out of the prison and in terrible health, having been grievously wounded in the war. He comes back to the United States, where Congress votes him about $12,000 in back pay, which in those days is an enormous sum of money. If you want to figure it out, you can go online and you get all kinds of weird calculations. $12,000 could be anything from $200,000 today to $1.2 million today, depending on how you calculate. But it doesn't matter. What really matters is this is a whole lot of money. And he doesn't take this money with him when he leaves the United States a year and a half later. Instead, he leaves it in the hands of his friend Thomas Jefferson, who he's become very good friends with. If any of you know anything about Jefferson's life, you realize that this was the seeds of economic catastrophe, because Jefferson is the most incompetent manager of money that you could ever have imagined. One can only imagine what American history would have been like if he'd given the money to Hamilton and said, invest this for me. And there would be, you know, a Kosciuszko University in the United States endowed at the level of Harvard or Princeton. But he leaves it in Jefferson's hands. And the deal is that Jefferson will watch the money and invest it and send the interest to Thaddeus when he is back in Europe. And just before he leaves, he presents Jefferson with a will, the famous first American will, which is actually here on this card if you have it. You can pick it up and read it. But basically what the will says is that I want my money to go to my friend Thomas Jefferson for the purpose of Jefferson buying and emancipating some of his own slaves. This is an enormously important statement about how to deal with what will become, and I would say what remains, the single most problematic aspect of American history, slavery and race relations. This is a man who, by the way, throughout the war, and I urge all of you to look at the book Three Friends of Liberty by Gary Nash and Graham Hodges, because, of course, the two are General and Jefferson, but the third is Agrippa Hall, who is the black aide to Thaddeus through much of the war. And he comes away from the war both anti-slavery and anti-racist. And that is an extraordinary insight for someone who has just come to the United States. And so he writes this will in which he says that Jefferson should use the money to buy his own slaves and free them. And then he goes back to Europe. He spends time in France. He spends time in Poland. He ends up in Switzerland. And eventually he dies, as we all do. And he corresponds with Jefferson on and off during this period. And when he dies, Jefferson walks into the county court in Virginia and says, I have this will of this late great American hero, and I am named the executor of the will, and I decline to accept the role as executor. Jefferson says that Kosciuszko was as pure a son of liberty as I have ever known, and of that liberty which is to go to all, not to the few or the rich alone. And it was to go to black people as well as white people. So what do we do with this will, and how do we understand it? The first thing to understand, and it might be hard for some people in this audience to come to terms with this, is that if there was any single man in the United States who you should not entrust money to, not only for investing, but for the purpose of fighting slavery, that single man was Master Thomas of Monticello, a man whose earliest memory was being carried on a pillow by a slave, and whose probably last memory, if he still had it on his deathbed, was sex with Sally Hemings, his slave, who he had as a mistress for his whole life, but who he did not bother to free in his will and never acknowledged that she was entitled to anything. This is a man who assiduously increased the number of his slaves throughout his life, whose slaveholding grew and grew and grew. And this is a man who bought and sold human beings the way some of us go to the grocery store. And it is important to understand this when we understand the will. Because when our emancipationist Polish general is in Philadelphia being good friends with Jefferson for a year and a half in the 1790s, they are undoubtedly talking about slavery. They are undoubtedly talking about the problem of slavery. And I am sure that Jefferson is nodding and saying, oh yes, of course slavery is a problem. Oh yes, of course slavery is something we need to deal with. Yes, it's terrible about these poor slaves. At the same time that he is writing letters to his overseer telling him to sell human beings because of Jefferson's constant importation of fine wine and antiques and art from France. Now, I appreciate Jefferson's taste in wine. He ordered some of my favorite wines, if only I were a millionaire and could afford them. But one might think that the taste of the wine would have been a little off when you realize that it was paid for in a misery, because selling a slave always meant that families would be divided. Children would be separated from parents, husbands from wives, wives from husbands, cousins, siblings, people you've known your whole life you would never see again. We get Thomas Jefferson in the textbook as the man who wrote, "We're all created equal and we're endowed with the rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." We don't get the Jefferson who writes to his overseer and says, "I'm tired of the behavior," and then he names a slave. "I want you to go to his cabin at 3 a.m. and take him down the mountain and sell him. And when the people wake up and ask what happened to him, you will simply say he is gone. And you will say nothing else, and it will be as though the earth had swallowed him up." And sadly, this is the man that is entrusted with carrying out this will. And so when Jefferson hears that his friend has died, he doesn't take the money, which oddly enough had actually grown because Jefferson was smart enough not to invest it himself, but to give it to somebody in Washington to invest. So it had actually grown. He doesn't say, okay, I'm gonna take this money and I'm gonna start freeing slaves. He does nothing except to go to the court and say, "Relieve me of this burden because I am too old to accept the burden." The only problem is he is not too old to be actively involved in politics. He is not too old to be lobbying for the creation of the University of Virginia. He is not too old to be fighting with people politically all over the country. He's too old to lift so much as his pinky finger to help slaves and to end slavery. Now, that's one piece of the story. The other piece, and I know we are short on time tonight, and the problem with having the professor go first is that I can only think in 45-minute and hour and 15-minute blocks, if those of you remember your college years, but I will try to make this brief. The other problem with this story is that Kosciuszko writes four wills in his life. And in this first will, the 1798 will, he says that this should be what was done with his money. Should I make no other testamentary disposition of my property? This typeface is unreadable here. Any other testamentary disposition of my property in the United States, I authorize my friend Thomas Jefferson to do this. He subsequently writes three wills. One of them in 1806 is to give about $3,600, which again is an enormous sum of money, to the son of General John Armstrong. The son's name is, his first name is Kosciuszko, so he is the, he gets the money because he's got the right first name. He then, in 1816, sends a letter to Jefferson saying that he is dying soon, and he knows that Jefferson is going to do what needs to be done with the will, with the estate. And then a month later, he rewrites the will, writes a completely new will, and doesn't mention his American money, his American estate. And then a year later, he writes yet another will. So the story of this tragedy is, and this is where the New York Historical Society for the New York Courts comes in, if you're going to write a will, get a good lawyer. Get somebody who knows how to write a will. And sit down with your lawyer and explain to your lawyer what it is that you want. And make sure in no uncertain terms that your executor is going to carry out the desire that is set in the will. I think it is quite clear as a historian that what he wanted was for his European property to be divided among his various relatives in Poland and friends in Switzerland, where he had lived for the last 3 years of his life. That he had wanted the son of his friend General Armstrong to get $3,600 because that seemed like a good number to give him. And he wanted the rest to be used to at least begin to dismantle slavery in the United States. That is clearly what he wanted. That comes loud and clear in the historical record. Unfortunately, that's not what he did. Instead, he wrote four wills. He doesn't take into account in the last two wills, the first two wills. And as a result, he lives on, not only in American history, not only in institutions like this, but in the U.S. Supreme Court, where his will is litigated four times, and continues to be litigated from the 1820s into the 1850s. And eventually, the great nieces and nephews will get the money that was supposed to go to his sister and his sister's children. This, for those of you who want to end all this on a literary note, you need to go read Dickens's Bleak House, because this is the story of Jarndyce versus Jarndyce, the estate that goes on and on and on. And in that book, Dickens says that no honest man will ever suffer any wrong that can be done. He says this, he says, an honorable man among lawyers who practice in chancery will, quote, suffer any wrong that can be done rather than come here to chancery court. And sadly, this great will and this great moment for freedom dies in chancery courts in America. Thank you.
I apologize this evening for my dour demeanor. But yesterday, my sister's husband, my brother-in-law, died. And tomorrow I'm going to his funeral. And he died from a historic event that was a few blocks from here. He was a firefighter on 9/11, and he died from 9/11-related cancer, brain cancer. So it's been a very, very emotional couple of days and weeks for me. Also, being in this building, a historic building, is also quite emotional for me, because in this building, Kosciuszko came to a dinner at the end of the American Revolution, where George Washington was meeting with the generals that helped him win the American Revolution. And when you see the paintings of that dinner, and when you see the historical references to that dinner, Kosciuszko is often sort of a footnote. But he was actually, other than Washington, the star of that dinner. Because at that dinner, George Washington gave him two swords engraved in Latin, saying that George Washington and the people of the United States are with Kosciuszko and the people of Poland. And then the organization that they were starting, the Order of Cincinnatus, which was named after Cincinnatus, a general farmer from ancient Rome, who left his farm to come and free his people, then went back to his farm. And on his finger, George Washington had a figure of Cincinnatus, and he slipped it off his finger, and he put it on Kosciuszko's hand and said, "You're going back to Poland, gentleman farmer, warrior, to go back to your own country and try to do what you did for this country here." And that happened in this building. And American historians don't write about this. American historians ignore Kosciuszko. And the reason they ignore Kosciuszko is one of the reasons, you can't pronounce his name. But another reason is that he didn't seek the limelight. He was very much, you know, in the shadows. He was a servant, he was a public servant. And we heard, you know, what was his motivation for coming to America? I'll tell you his motivation for coming to America. He studied at military academies in Warsaw, and then left and studied at military academies in Paris, where, because he was not a French citizen, couldn't enroll officially at these military academies. So he basically would seek out these professors afterwards and learn about Rousseau and all these great thinkers of the time. And the one thinker that impressed him the most, there was a philosophy called physiocracy. And physiocracy basically said that all wealth comes from the land, and the people who own the land get rich. And why do they get rich? Because they have indentured servants, essentially slaves, working the land and making that land more valuable for them. And he was very upset by this. And he knew that what's going on right now with Francois Canet and physiocracy in France is what's going on in Poland. And he comes back to Poland, and he's a captain at the time, and he can't get a job in the military because you had to buy military positions in Europe at the time. So he gets a job teaching the daughter of one of the richest men in Poland, Ludwiga Sosnowska. And he starts teaching her about physiocracy and about how great the French are. They want to give the land, and this laissez-faire. When we hear about laissez-faire in America, It's usually Republicans saying, well, hands off business. The business needs to be more rich, and we're strangling business. That's not what laissez-faire meant initially. Laissez-faire meant hands off the workers who are making us wealthy. Let them have more of the fruits of their labor, and they will work harder, will get richer, they'll be comfortable. So he comes back, he's teaching Ludwiga Sosnowska about this, all physiocracy, and she says, listen, when you were in Paris studying painting and philosophy, my sister and I translated the first book about physiocracy from French into Polish. So don't tell us about physiocracy. We know all about it. And he's sort of surprised that this woman he's in love with, he later fell in love with her and tried to elope with her, has the same ideals and freeing, you know, serfs and the underprivileged classes. And he tries to elope with her. And the father says, no, you're not going to elope with my daughter. He says, pigeons don't marry sparrows. And the daughters of the upper class don't marry the middle class. And so they try to elope, and the father wants to get Kosciuszko, arrest him, and kill him because he tried to elope with his daughter. So Kosciuszko flees. He goes to Paris, and he comes to America. He doesn't know anything really other than what he read about, you know, the Boston Tea Party. The only American he had heard of was Benjamin Franklin. So he goes and knocks on Benjamin Franklin's door and says, I'm here to take your test on military engineering. And Franklin says, what? a test on, we're a country of farmers and merchants. We don't have such what's the test again? And he says, and you came all this way to fight in the revolution without any letters of recommendation? And he says, no, by my own, you know, motions will show what I can do in this country. And Franklin looks at him, gets up, kisses him on the forehead, and says, we don't have a test on that, but we have a test on geometry. Come back and take the test on geometry. Kosciuszko comes back, aces the test on geometry. Franklin says, good, you're in charge of building forts. So he starts building all of these forts around Philadelphia. And he sees what they're doing and says, well, the British ships are coming in. And what I learned in Paris is this thing called a chevaux de frise. You take a tree, you shave it down, you put it underwater, you put a whole bunch of them in a row with rocks, and it's under the water level. When the ship comes in, this puts a hole in the ship. It sinks. End of story. And now all of a sudden, George Washington wants him. General Gates wants him. All these generals, well, who's this engineer? But I don't want to talk about his military, the things he did in the American Revolution, which were very important. He built West Point. What did Benedict Arnold do? Who was Benedict Arnold, professor? You must have read a different book than I have. That's right. You read Hodges' book. You know, you got to push Hodges' book. It's a childhood friend.
No, there's a
he actually was
his boots.
His boots. When he got shot off his horse. Right. I was going to talk about tolerance, but now that you mentioned Saratoga, you had to go there, didn't you? There was one word related with Benedict Arnold. It's traitor. But at the Battle of Saratoga, being that you brought it up, American historians say, oh, Benedict Arnold was the hero of Saratoga. He raced down the hill and shot. And Benedict Arnold at Saratoga was a disaster. And American historians won't tell you this. And the reason he was a disaster was because General Horatio Gates knew that he has an engineer who built, you know, did all these things. So he creates a bottleneck. Kosciuszko created a trap at Saratoga where the British soldiers with those red things are marching up, you know, banging the drum, and they're marching into a bottleneck and they're shooting down on them. And what Benedict Arnold did at Saratoga, unbeknownst to him, they didn't have any bullets left or muskets left or gunpowder. So they knew that it was going to be, that first battle was going to be a battle with bayonets. This isn't even working. Why am I even?
They knew it was going to be a battle with bayonets. We come and you stab it. And the bayonets that the British had were these very complex bayonets that stick out this way and this way. And these guys had a bunch of muskets, maybe a hammer. So they said, we'll march them up into this trap. And they marched up into this trap. And they're waiting. They're waiting, they're waiting, they're waiting. They're shooting them up into the trap. Benedict Arnold runs down. He gets drunk, he runs down and shoots, and Gates calls him aside and goes, what are you doing? We don't have any gunpowder left. There's no gunpowder. That's why we have this trap. They're supposed to march up into the trap. And so he puts him aside, and so they wait, and they send guys to Albany, to the Schuyler House, I think, actually, and they take the window panes out, and they melt them for lead to make musket balls. And so the second battle, again, Benedict Arnold runs down, gets shot, gets whatever.
So this is a major misconception about Benedict Arnold, who almost ruined the Battle of Saratoga. Instead of letting them come up and get caught in this trap, and at the end of the battle, General Horatio Gates meets with Dr. Rush, and he says, wow, you're a great hero. You won the Battle of Saratoga. And he says, no. There was a Polish engineer who, by where he put the cannons and where he put the guns, he won the Battle of Saratoga. And after this, they put him in charge of building West Point. He does all these things. But that's not what I wanted to talk about, is him as a military hero. Because for me, who Kosciuszko really was, he was a prince of tolerance ahead of his time. Think about it. We heard the professors talk earlier. He tried to buy enslaved African people with his own money and free them. Think about that for a second. How many of us are willing to empty our wallets right now and help either Syrian refugees or other people that are being, you know, that are suffering in some horrible way? Not many of us. But he was willing to give his entire American estate to purchase enslaved Africans and free them. And one of the things that was most important in his will was in his will, he says, Mr. Jefferson, take out of my salary this money and buy me Negroes, he says. But make sure there's enough money to buy them land, farming tools, and cattle, and educate them so that they can make their own living in this country and not be reliant on anyone else. And then he goes back to Poland, where he tries to free indentured servants, the white peasants under feudalism, who were also slaves. Let's not call them anything else. Serfs were slaves. They weren't as viciously treated as African slaves were here. But if you owned land, you owned the people on your land who farmed your land and made you rich. So he tried to free them. And he stood up for Native Americans in America. When he saw that George Washington, that they were killing all of these indigenous tribes, he stood up for them. And there was a Chief Little Turtle who comes to his room in Philadelphia and says, we hear you're this righteous white man who stands up for everybody. We're giving you this tomahawk. And on one side of the tomahawk is a blade, on the other side is a peace pipe. And Kosciuszko is so honored at this peace pipe, you know. And he's looking around the room. He didn't expect this Native American chief to come in and give him a present. And he gives him this jacket that he wore. And then he gives him two pistols. And he says, I use these pistols to try and free the enslaved of my own race. Now you use them against the first person that comes and tries to take this land from you. And then he gives him glasses. And this chief puts the glasses on. He says, my God, you've given me new eyes. And he goes and he tells the Native American tribes about his new friend, Kosciuszko. Everybody pronounced his name differently, Kosciuszko. The French pronounce it one way. When Kosciuszko arrived in America, he only spoke French, so everybody thought, oh, he must be French. Washington thought he was French at first. And Washington puts him in charge of building West Point. And in all of the correspondence, Washington spells his name 11 different ways until he meets him. And Kosciuszko shows him what he wants to do at West Point. And the French generals that came were giving him a hard time. And after meeting him, he said, do it the way this Polish guy says. His way is better. So I think I'm limited on time. Is that wrapping up? So I'll just finish up by saying, you know, what was he motivated by? He was motivated by freedom for everyone, whether you were Catholic or Jewish. He had Muslims in his army in Poland. Think about it. He had an army in Poland that had Catholics, Muslims, and Jews fighting side by side against Catherine the Great. That's pretty impressive in itself. And he used to say, he wrote in a letter to his sister, we are all equal. The only difference is education and wealth. Some of us have more of it than others. So that's why he tried hard to educate everyone. And one last thought on his will. He wrote these four different wills. When he wrote these wills, he wrote them in different languages, in different cities. He wrote one will in Philadelphia, or two, dealing with his American estate. So he said, this pot of money in America, I want you to use it for this purpose. And then my estate in Poland, which he wrote in Polish, I want you to use this money to free the serfs on my sister's farm and let her kids have this money. And then he got money from a Russian czar, which he kept in London and never touched, and gave that to a different friend. And then Switzerland wrote. So he never thought these wills would be, it's not like the internet now, where you go, oh, where's his will? Kosciuszko's will. He had it in different cities where, so he never expected these wills to be joined together. So my thought on how do you pronounce Kosciuszko? It's very easy. Freedom.
Kosciuszko actually sat down to write music. As we know, he was born in a family of noble origins. He excelled in his military studies and was sent by King Stanisław August Poniatowski to study in France. And there, as Alex mentioned, he actually was not formally enrolled in military studies. He did that after school. He actually studied painting. So his art background was also quite strong. Out of the very few surviving pieces by Tadeusz Kosciuszko, I have two to share with you, a Polonaise and a waltz. They're both dances in triple meter, consisting of multiple sections and carefully prescribed modulations. And I just wanted to say a few words before I play these rarities. Kosciuszko was born 10 years before Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, and he certainly was a man of the Enlightenment. Was aware of the musical canons of the epoch and wrote in that classical style to the letter. One of the most recognizable features of this music is what's called an Alberti Bay. And it sounds like this. So if you were to listen to a Mozart sonata, you hear that in my left hand. Well, sure enough, Kosciuszko did a very good job at picking that up, and his Polonaise. Show you that he was very much up to date with the musical fashion of the time. The Polonaise usually has, being a Polish dance, it has this very characteristic rhythm. And here is a little bit of the Chopin military Polonaise, just for reference. And so Kosciuszko starts his Polonaise, of course, classical style. He was perfectly aware again of the canon. You will notice that the sections of the Polonaise repeat quite a lot. And so, just so to give you a little bit of a background, why this happens? Because today, when we have home music entertainment, we are used to just dialing something up if we want to hear it again. But back in the 1780s, that was not the case. So that was the only way to hear the piece thoroughly, by actually hearing it twice. A polonaise is also a dance, as is the waltz. So symmetry in dance is of utmost importance. And when you also hear it as a new composition, you know, today we are used to revering and reviving music of the olden times. But back in the 1780s, the music that was written was performed and then forgotten. People just quickly moved on. So that was yet another way, just to get yet another quick glimpse of the piece before it disappears forever. The musical audiences were also quite different. The Age of Enlightenment sees a growing base of concert goers. The public concerts are relatively a new concept, really only starting during late Baroque. And so for the first time, one does not need to be a member of the royal court to hear great music. One can just buy a ticket. But in order to go and enjoy the concert, you like to feel like you're getting your money's worth and that you understand what's happening in music. And so these repetitions of these sections will also provide that. So you may think that this piece lacks originality, but there is one spot that stands out to me in particular, where this man, really going the canon of the classical music, really reveals his personality in this bugle call here. So listen for that, and here is the Polonaise Kosciuszko. The date here of the fax, October 6, 2009, and that person was Tom Pniewski. Some of you may remember Tom as the curator of events at the Kosciuszko Foundation. I just learned yesterday that Tom has passed away. I was very saddened by this. So for those of you who remembered Tom, I hope you sent him a smile, thinking of his kindness and his passion for music, his enthusiasm, and for what he said, we were exchanging thoughts with Magda Mazurek yesterday, how sending this music, he said, well, this may not be the greatest masterpieces, but it will surely provide for an interesting musical evening. So I do hope that it is the case for us all tonight. Now, before I play the waltz, I'd just like to say a few words about the instrument itself. So the piano, as we see it today in its form, did not yet exist. So these pieces were originally written for the harpsichord, which is the predecessor of the piano. And instead of the notes being produced by a hammer striking a string, it actually is a plectrum plucking it. So the sound of the Kosciuszko pieces would have been a little bit more guitar-like on the harpsichord. The instrument, being a sort of a symbol of aristocracy and all things aristocratic, very quickly became firewood in the French Revolution and replaced by the piano. Now the waltz, many of you know, is a popular ballroom dance, but before it became that, it was actually a peasant dance. And so reportedly, some of the bored noblemen would sneak out of their minuet balls and join the waltzing peasants. And the waltz was danced in a much more of an embraced and closed way. So in the 1770s, it was considered shameless and indecent. But by the 1790s, it was all the rage all over Europe. And that is the year of Kosciuszko's death. And the young musician's name is Frédéric Chopin. He was very sensitive to things that happened in his country, having left Poland, having to have to leave Poland at age 20 and being unable to return before his death. Now his heart is actually in the Holy Cross Church in Warsaw. The rest of his remains are being in a Père Lachaise cemetery in Paris. But I would like to play an example of what the piano can do, true virtuosity, but also a true range of emotions, from whisper to a roaring climax.
And his father served in Kosciuszko's army.
Your father?
Thank you.
Institute as Museum of Food and Drinks back in May this year. And I think for the toast, we would like to propose the hashtag that served us very well, because this is how we met. Throughout the whole year that we're celebrating Kosciuszko, we came up with the hashtag General Kosciuszko, we salute you. And I think that's it. So enjoy it.